Listening Library presents The Adventures of Sir Balin the Ill-Fated, The Knight's Tales, Book 4, by Gerald Morris. Read for you by Steve West. Prologue. On a quiet night in Northumberland, a family gathered in the richly furnished parlour of their castle. Beside a roaring fire stood a young father in a velvet robe. Nearby sat a young mother in the stylish gown of a noblewoman. A small boy slept on a rug by the fire, and an even smaller boy lay in a bassinet at his mother's feet.
"Well, I think it was a lovely christening," the mother said contentedly.
The father smiled. "My dear, you would have thought it was lovely if the sky had fallen during the service. Remember how it stormed the night that Balin was christened? You said that was lovely too."
"It was," the mother replied.
She looked at the baby in the basket.
"Isn't he beautiful?"
The father smiled again.
"My dear, you would say he was beautiful even if..." "I said, isn't he beautiful?"
interrupted the mother. "Yes, dear, very beautiful." At that moment, the parlour door burst open. The fire shuddered in a cold draught, and a grey woman in a grey cloak tapped into the room, supported by a curiously carved staff. The man stepped between the stranger and his wife.
"I say, who the deuce are you?"
"I," said the woman, pausing dramatically, "I am the old woman of the mountain."
"Which mountain?" asked the father.
"It matters not,"
replied the old woman of the mountain, waving her hand dismissively. The father frowned.
"It matters when you're trying to get home, doesn't it? I mean, deuce it. How do you know when you've arrived if it isn't a particular..."
"Hush,"
intoned the old woman of a mountain.
"I am here for your son's christening."
"That's so kind of you," said the mother. "But you know, the service ended more than an hour ago."
"What? Isn't it at 4 o'clock?
"Yes, it was,"
said the father and mother together. The old woman of a mountain somewhere scowled, and the mother added,
"I'm sure it's not your fault. The days are getting shorter all the time, and it's easy to get confused."
"Hang on," said the father.
"Let me think about that. If she was confused by the days getting shorter, wouldn't she have been an hour early?"
"No, dear," said the mother. "If she thought it was 3 because of the daylight..."
"Hush,"
repeated the old woman of some mountain.
"I am here for your son's sake. I will tell you his future and his blessing."
"Isn't that lovely?" beamed the mother. "Will he marry a nice northern girl?"
"Why do you want to do that?" the father asked the grey woman.
"It is what the old woman of the mountain does," she explained.
"You didn't do it when our older son, Balin, was christened," the father pointed out. The old woman reddened slightly.
"I meant to," she said, "but it was raining that day. I thought it might clear up, so I waited, but it never did."
"How can you tell my son's future if you can't even tell if it's going to stop raining?" asked the father.
"I do babies, not weather," said the old woman. "What is your child's name?"
The mother tickled her infant's chin and said,
"This is Balin."
The old woman opened her mouth, then hesitated.
"But isn't that your older son's name?"
"No, no," the mother explained. "My older son is Balin."
"Eh?"
"Balin and Balin,"
the mother enunciated.
"Won't that be a problem?"
asked the old woman.
"I mean, really? Matching names?"
She looked at the father,
who peeked at his wife from the corner of his eye, then shrugged. The mother smiled dreamily.
My boys will match in every way. They'll wear matching clothes and have matching coverlets on their beds and matching curtains on their windows and be the very best of friends.
The old woman of a mountain looked faintly ill.
You're joking, right?
No, why?
The crone looked again at the father.
They'll hate it. You know that, don't you? I mean, seriously, you can't let...
The father avoided his wife's eyes and cleared his throat.
Look here, weren't you going to bless Balin or something?
Very well, she said with a shrug.
Tapping her way over, she held her hand above the infant.
Ah, she said.
The young parents waited expectantly, but for a long minute she said nothing more.
Is that it?
Asked the father at last. The old woman ignored him.
I see greatness in this child, she said at last.
The mother smiled.
He shall be known as the noblest knight in England. But wait, there's more. I see a cloud over his greatness, like the mist on the mountain.
Which mountain? Asked the father.
And will he marry a nice northern girl? Asked the mother.
I see destruction and calamity. His greatness shall bring misfortune on all his companions. He shall do marvelous deeds, but they will only serve him ill. In one day, he shall bring down two kingdoms. He shall strike the dolorous stroke.
The what stroke? Asked the father.
The dolorous one.
The father frowned, and the old woman added,
It means sad.
Why not say sad, then? Asked the father.
He shall be brave above all knights. He shall never refuse an adventure.
That's nice, the mother said. Now, when he gets married...
But all his adventures shall bring misfortune.
The father stepped forward and took the old woman's elbow.
Well, I want to thank you for stopping by. It's been...
And in the end, the old woman said, he shall destroy the knight whom he loves most in the world.
A deathly silence hung over the parlor. The old woman of an unknown mountain wrapped her gray cloak about her defiantly. At last, the child's father said,
Look here, if that's the best blessing you have to offer, I'm glad you missed Balan's christening. Now, if you're done, I don't want to keep you.
I have spoken,
the old woman declared.
Yes, we heard you, said the father, ushering her to the door. And to be perfectly frank, we all wish you'd put a cork in it instead.
He guided her out the door, then closed it firmly behind her.
Never mind, dear, said the mother,
tickling her infant's chin again.
I know you'll marry a nice northern girl.
The father looked at his son thoughtfully.
You sure have an awful lot of destiny hanging over you, little snip, he murmured.
He's not a little snip,
the mother declared stoutly.
No, dear, of course not, said the father.
But still, he looked grave. Chapter 1. The Knight with Two Swords. On a day some 20 years after these events, King Arthur held court. Now, most people know that King Arthur became king by drawing an enchanted sword from a stone. Many also know that he established a band of noble heroes, called the Knights of the Round Table. Some even know that he ruled wisely and well and brought peace to all England. But not many realize how long all this took. On this particular day, the king had already drawn the sword from the stone, But he had no round table and only a few knights, and he ruled only a small part of England. Many powerful nobles were waging war with him, resisting his reign, which kept King Arthur quite busy. Nevertheless, he was already trying to rule.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.